started getting into music and how the progressive rock scene was sort of emerging and how you sort of got on board, if you know.
I was originally interested in music. My mother was a played keyboards. She played stride piano. She was a fan of Fats Waller, so she used to play quite a lot. She always wanted me to learn piano. I wanted to learn the clarinet. I was impressed with people like Benny Goodman and people like that, but a lot of black players as well. That was what turned me on. And then I was also impressed with Charlie Parker on the saxophone and Earl Bostick, who had a hit record called Flamingo, which I loved the sound of. And my uncle played clarinet. There was a music teacher 100 yards up the road from where I lived. I lived in Margate at the time. And I bought myself a clarinet and went to him for lessons. And he showed me a few tricks. And I was able to get away with playing a few tunes. Actually, the first record I bought was a song called 12th Street Rag by Pee Wee Hunt. And I still can remember the clarinet solo in it. It's a song that goes da 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 playing my songs. I've got a huge repertoire of material, having played in lots of different bands, played in blues bands, and I played in traditional jazz bands, and I played in modern jazz bands as well. I was always impressed by Charlie Parker and all the sax players, John Coltrane, all those people. They really impressed me with the groovy music that they played.
How did you get into space rock?
Accidentally, really. You know, I was in Holland at the time, working on a rock and roll circus, and one of the bands that came and played there was comprised of Dave Brock and Mick Slattery, and they were sort of talking about forming a band. They had a band already, but they invited me to join it. And that's how I got involved with space rock, really. I sort of was impressed by Michael Moorcock, the science fiction writer, and lots of other people like him. I used to know, when I was a teenager, I used to hang out with all these American service people, like pilots, because Manston Air Force Base was near to Margate. And I used to be the sports partner to all these fighter pilots. I used to play tennis with them and I'd go cross-country running. I'd go swimming with them in the middle of the winter, stuff like that. And I was just very impressed with them. And then they used to give me all their pulp fiction stuff and all the old Arthur Clarke books and stuff like that, like Childhood's End. I don't know if you read science fiction.
Yeah.
I used to read a lot of science fiction. I still do, actually, on occasions. Although I'm rather reading the sort of books I read when I was a teenager. Pulp fiction stuff. You know, cheap gangsters and stuff like that.
So in the 60s, obviously, the sort of space was emerging with Telstar satellite being launched. Do you think that influenced the sort of sound of the space rock era?
I think so, yeah.
Just elaborate on that.
Yeah, I still go for that sound. I'm still impressed with the spaciness. And Robert Calvert was a friend of mine. He lived in Ramsgate. We used to hang out together. We used to go out getting stoned and drunk and taking LSD and all sorts like that, staying up all night and keeping the neighbours awake. Yeah, so I was always into sort of the noir sort of mythologies and stuff, and still am.
You were telling me earlier about the saxophone that you'd painted it. Just tell us the story of the saxophone again.
Well, yeah, I started playing the saxophone. I bought a clarinet first of all because I was impressed. My uncle played clarinet, and there was a guy up the road who gave music lessons. He was sort of bandmaster for the local Marines band, and he taught all the local boys, taught them all Charlie Parker licks and all that sort of thing, and John Coltrane, you know. He was quite an avant-garde sort of guy, and I told him I liked Charlie Parker, and he said, oh, get an alto sax. So I was learning the clarinet at the same time, and I got an alto sax, and he taught me a load of riffs and stuff like that, sort of this thing Charlie Parker played, and set me off in the right direction, really. Gave me a kick up the arse and got me going.
Tell me a little bit about how you painted the saxophone.
Well, I bought that one in 1973. It was new then. It was the year my dad died, and I thought I would treat myself to a saxophone. So I went to a music shop in the West End, where I acquainted myself with a couple of people that worked there. Said I wanted a good saxophone, and they said, oh, you want a Selma Mark VI? So I said, yeah, that's one for me, thanks. So I bought one, and I've been playing it ever since. That was in 1973, and it's a classic model. It's probably worth about $5,000, that saxophone, although it looks like a piece of crap. I haven't looked after it. When I bought it, I thought, oh, I'd like to make it really spacey. So I painted it. I painted flames coming out of the bell. I painted magic mushrooms all over it. Stuff like that, all psychedelic stuff. So it was really quite unique. You didn't see anything like that around at that time. Although more recently, I met a sax player that I worked with in LA, and he painted his saxophone. He's an old boy. He was showing me films of him lying on the floor in a nightclub playing the saxophone. And he had painted it all. It's quite cool, really.
Was it unusual in that period to introduce sort of brass instruments into rock music?
Yeah, nobody had a paint on brass instruments. It dampened the sound. That's what people concluded. Although I played it for 15 years or something like that, with the paint on it. I ended up in a big band with the paint on all over it. And that was really good, you know. Quite innovative and wild and wacky. Like really how I wanted to be seen. What I was inspired by, really. Science fiction imagery and fun.
So how was it working with Dave Brock?
Oh, it's great. Yes, it's ideal, I think. You know, I don't know if I played with one guy in America who painted his sax. He's an old boy, a black guy, and he was really good. But I think it was a very apt sort of thing to have done. I think so.
That's great. Perfect.
So, Willie, thank you.